Good evening, Paul. Welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me.
Let's read through the Buhari's administration, the two floated finance acts, 1919 and 2020. What's your assessment of these two enabling documents?
Well, I think Mr. President and his team, they're trying best possible to ensure that paying taxes become much easier for Nigerians. I recall that paying taxes is one of the parameters that is used to measure doing business in Nigeria. As I speak, out of 190 countries, Nigeria, according to doingbusiness.org, is rated 159 when it comes to paying taxes. Government have identified some of these loopholes, in my own understanding, and is coming up with, I think, strategies of how to make it more convenient, more comfortable for people. So when you look at 2019, what government did, there's new exemptions which government gave to businesses. And I think 2020 Act, Finance Act, is to clarify issues with 2019, which of course seems not to be cleared. For instance, when we talk of minimum wage, someone who earns 30,000 naira and below will now be exempted for payee. 2019 already classified for the first time companies into three different categories. We have small businesses, a company between 0 naira turnover to 25 million. We have medium scale businesses. Small businesses are to now file zero as company income tax, and that has not changed. And it's also remain in 2020 because it wasn't amended. We also have 25 million to 100 million. We are now to pay 20% as against 30%. That was a blanket figure before 2019 Act. And what remains is above 100 million company that was turnover above 100 million naira today. That still remains. So there's been some review to show to reflect the reality. 2019 called recognized 50 naira stamp duty, and I guess because there were issues between FRS and post office at the time, postmaster said stamp duty should be collected by post office. But of course, that has now been changed to electronic charge, which of course drops and makes the argument of post office now irrelevant because the amount was reviewed. And I also think government has realized that for us to move the nation forward, there is need for more vehicles, because at the time, the cost of vehicle was increasing beyond measure. We also have some correction regarding, and clarification, I beg your pardon, regarding VAT on property. Even though it was there, but it was not well clarified. As we speak, the 2020 Act has clarified it, and I think there is more clarity coming up with this document, 2020.
So if we drill down a little bit more, Paul, into some of the benefits that the two Finance Act have delivered. First, for businesses in Nigeria, do you think within the last 2 years we've seen the benefits of the Finance Act, the previous one, or the first one?
Yes, well, the benefit directly, I think small businesses and medium-scale businesses have a lot to gain. Those who had filed 30%, it has significantly reduced to 20%. That means shareholders can now get, for companies that are owned by shareholders and properly structured. But you and I know companies within that sector are not structured, even though they are to pay taxes. And those who might have been running illegal business with small businesses who have not been paying taxes, I think they are off the hook if they are doing less than 25 million, as mentioned by government. A whole lot more regarding VAT. We also try to watch the figures coming from government to see significant improvement in what is generated by the states and the federal government regarding value-added tax. And I can tell you that even though this policy did not envisage that there would be COVID-19, which of course has ravaged many parts of the world, including Nigeria. You may not want to measure accurately right now because of the unique environment we live in right now because of the pandemic. You cannot vividly measure the impact maybe until after 2021, when significant proportion of global population would have been vaccinated, then you can now feel the real impact. Right now, I think government has actually reduced some charges because when an economy is in a recession, that is not the time for you to increase tax or to increase taxes on such economy. And I think this is the reason why we are seeing some reduced charges. And the impact in 2021, of course, will be larger than what we have in 2020.
Paul, speaking about the coronavirus and what is raging around the world, let's continue our conversation around the Finance Act. Do you think it has benefited the ordinary Nigerians?
Well, I think this Finance Act, the new one, particularly this amendment, if you like, we benefit almost everybody. Some of the clauses do. It does not mean that everybody will be one way or the other taxed as burden. But when you see that from 35%, the payment of tax on trucks and cars is now being reviewed to 5%, I think that is big news for agric sector, agricultural sector, which government is focusing on, and also for those who might be importing cars, which of course is the middle class on the majority. Commercial vehicles, talking about commercial vehicle that is more than 10 persons, is now being reviewed in terms of duties from 35% to 30%. These are many more. And you also have a possible review for those who are operating primary production in agriculture in terms of pioneer status, which may be given to them for 4 years plus two, which is, it could be 4 years, but not more than 6 years. When you look at this, I think government is trying to achieve certain aims to make policy, to follow some of the promises made, particularly for agriculture. It does not mean that the rich is also exempted, as VAT has been removed on property and, more importantly, on air tickets. So about 7.5%, which of course would have been added ab initio, is also removed. So when you look at it, government seems to have targeted the poor by saying that 30%, I mean, those who earn 30,000 naira and below has now been exempted from paying any form of personal income taxes. Also targeted the middle class, particularly those who buy either brand new cars and majorly used car, fairly used car coming from outside Nigeria. Duty is now also being reviewed from 35% to 5% for cars. In case of trucks and commercial vehicles, it's also being reviewed significantly. And when you look at this, you see that the burden of purchase is gradually leaving the demand side, that is the user, and is making their disposable income, of course, to have more meaning and more to be more useful to them.
So but the question, Paul, is this. This Finance Act, they're good, but is it the elixir that the Nigerian economy needs?
Well, I don't think so. I think Nigeria economy needs more than this. When you ask me that what is one thing I think government should quickly focus on, this is just 1 out of 10, ease of doing business. For me, we are focusing on 1 out of 10, and in any university, that will be 10%. But that does not mean that government is not doing something. Government is doing something. Unfortunately, it's just not sufficient. When you look at those things that have wrapped themselves around our neck and become stone in taking our economy backward, ease of paying taxes is one of them, registering property. More importantly, is access to power supply. And I've said for government to use, we can use any structural method. If you are not talking about power, we are still not solving the real issue. Countries that we want to be like, we have talked about top 20 countries in the world, 2020. The last IMF report shows that we are among the 25th countries when it comes to GDP. But when you slash that, that's when you use a denominator, talk about the population against the GDP of the country, we went really down from 25th position to 135th position. That will worry us, because that is jumping backward in 110 places using the same aggregation that World Bank made use of. So for me, I think government needs to do so much in terms of structural development, structural changes. That is what leads beyond growth. I think Nigerian government should also be looking beyond growth conversation to development conversation. And real development, we go beyond the numbers of what GDP is saying, of how much we pay in taxes. These are good policies government is making, but there are no fundamentals, there are no foundations that will make this policy strive.
I'm just about to ask you, Yes, if I earn less than 30,000 naira, I will be exempted from paying personal income tax. But the question is, does that resolve the key issues of my livelihood? For example, you talk about electricity. Does that take care of good roads? Does that take care of how do I even ensure that I get that 30,000 naira per month in the first place? Because you can only tax what I make. If I don't make anything, there's nothing for you to tax.
Well, for a family, I think the average in Nigeria still remain 4 children, 1 man, 1 wife. So we talk about 6, that is 5,000 per head. The kids need to go to school. They are resuming, I hear, on the 18th, I'm not sure, for most schools in Nigeria. If that happens, which school are they going to go? How will they transport to school? Knowing fully well that pump price slightly increased, and if there is electricity in the community where the poor live, I am not sure.
So you're speaking about inflation here and other things, an exchange rate.
Yeah, so when you look at all of those, you know that the 30,000, the best government can do is not to say part of 30,000 naira should be withdrawn. So the whole income goes to disposable income without charging any taxes from it. So, but you see, when we have structural development, structural change, we will not have cost to talk about improving labor salary. And I have said time and again that other than wage review, which government wants to do every 5 years, worst case scenario, 10 years, government should look at what labor really spend money on. That wants labor to always come for wage review. One of the reasons why we have university shutdown for 9 months, among other things, one of the reasons why we have labor threatening to go on strike a number of times, not just this administration, but several administrations before now, is how much is spent on transport, how much is spent on housing, how much is spent on electricity. How do we build a robust economy with strong foundation so that labor can have access to credits beyond what our commercial bank and microfinance banks are doing currently, so that what they earn will be sufficient and will not just be only basic, but we give them quality life. Then we can say when inflation is taken out and goods and services that are useful for life, that are needful for life, I beg your pardon, are also available, we can say that we are providing our people with our very best.
So you spoke a little bit earlier about growth and development. Separate the two for us.
Okay, so you growth is when your GDP figures, I'm talking purely theoretical, when the GDP figures increases. Most of the time, Nigerian government would use growth as a major parameter. For instance, we say we are the largest economy in Africa. Wait a minute, before you conclude on that, you need to take a step forward. Look at the Gini coefficient. When you distribute income among Nigerian population, according to IMF, Nigeria on growth alone, which is GDP, is about 25th position when you compare among countries of the world. But when you divide that with population, Nigeria will drop from 25th to 135th position using 2019 figures. And that said, there are other more important things when it comes to development conversation. There are three key things when it comes to human development index. The first is what is happening to income. Is your income increasing or decreasing? Now we say minimum wage is from 18,000 to 30,000. That was in 2018 or 2019, as the case may be. But what was exchange rate in 2018, 2019, what is exchange rate today? From 306 to 379, according to the budget presented by executive in 2020, which Mr. President signed to law, 31st December 2020. What it means is that what labor earned in 2018 or 19, as the case may be, is far less than what labor we earn today. And more people, are they getting more jobs or not? IMF said 5 million people had entered poverty bracket. Even though we want to take 10 million people out of poverty every year from 2019 to say 2029. And if you start from 2020, it will be to 2030. But I'm worried that we are not exactly achieving these aims that we hope to achieve in just 10 years. But that is just on income. Another major parameter out of the three is what is happening to education. Do we say that the quality, the kind of education Nigerian youths talk about, graduates, polytechnic, university, or colleges piece of education, what they are getting in school today is sufficient to take them to get them job or to give them the quality, the kind of life they want to live. Well, as for millions of people watching me now and those that will watch me in future, I know the answer may be on the nay side. And lastly, what is happening to income? What is happening to education? More importantly, what is happening to health? COVID-19 seems to have revealed more about our health sector. Now, so, not to just talk about the blame game, I think the focus should be, how do we build the kind of economy that we want to have? There have been several presentations, several propositions by different economics, but all economies that have developed seems to have followed part B of the argument, not just part A of income, health and education. They have followed the part of infrastructure first, and by infrastructure we mean power, we mean road, we mean rail. Whether you are going to borrow the money or you are going to generate the income, there are so many other options that are available for government to follow. But the part I follow, like so many other development economies, will be bring the infrastructure, look for private sector to partner with, generate all of these, education will come, and health will come. Why? Because as industry continue to employ more skilled labor, their health will become very important to them, and they will be able, they can afford to pay for their health concerns and also educate them for requirement for their industry and factories.
Paul Olaje, senior economist at SPM Professionals, thank you so much for your time this evening.